Hello and welcome to the Your Financial Pharmacist Real Estate Investing Podcast, a show all about empowering pharmacists to achieve financial freedom through real estate investing. I'm Nate Hedrick, and each week, my co-host David Bright and I explore stories from pharmacists all over the country who are achieving their real estate goals while maintaining a meaningful career in pharmacy. Whether you're a first-time investor or a seasoned pro, we're here to provide education and inspiration about the world of real estate. Please note, this podcast is intended for educational purposes only and should not be considered financial or investment advice. Hey, David, how's it going?
Hey, good, thanks. How you doing, man?
Quite well, sir. Quite well. It's the end of a nice weekend we have with the family and getting ready for another week.
Very nice. Very nice. It's apple picking season up here. So we were out picking apples at the orchard with the girls. It was a lot of fun. These fall weekends are great.
That's great. My girls love that too. That's awesome. We were talking a little bit more too. I noticed that your shelves behind you, and I know no one listening to this show can appreciate this, but the shelves behind you look a little bare. Tell me what's going on, David.
Yeah. So for those that can't see, I have a couple bookshelves behind me and there's always things on them, but we are staging a house right now to flip. So we were just loading that all in the van. One of the many things that my wife is really good at is staging houses. So she is off to stage a house for us tomorrow. And so, yeah, a lot of little things around the house. So like that bench would look great in that house, you know?
I was worried you were moving. You're like, no, just.
Yeah. No, we're just staging a house. Yeah. Yeah.
So I love it.
That's awesome. How that's going. Yeah. Yeah. How about you? I know you've been fighting this roof saga for weeks now. So what's the latest?
Yeah, it's going to, the saga should be ending here this week if all goes well and the weather holds. So Tuesday they're going to replace the roof. The long version, like, I think is interesting because we worked through a couple of different things that I think other investors could learn from. So I'll kind of tell the story really quickly, but basically the roof had a leak and the leak occurred after a storm. So the thought is, well, the storm caused the leak. Let's look at this from an insurance perspective. So let's file it as a claim and see where it takes us, right? So they bring out an adjuster whose job is to come out and basically assess whether or not it's a billable claim, whether or not it's a fileable claim. Well, they got up on the roof and took a look at it. And they actually went out with my contractor to look at the roof together. And of course, the contractor's pushing for our side where they're going to get the full claim, right? The contractor's like, yeah, look at all this damage. And the adjuster's like, I don't know. Anyway, so they look at it. And what they eventually decide is that the adjuster says, well, yes, on the windward side of your house, yes, there is damage to these roofing shingles. And this is obviously the cause of this problem. So we will cover where the damage is. But we have to replace the whole roof, right? It just, once we're up there, it doesn't make any sense to do just half of it. But the insurance claim basically would only cover, I think it ends up being about a third, maybe a little more of the roof. And so basically it comes down to about $3,000 or $4,000 that they'd be covering, which is, you know, again, a third the cost of the total roof replacement. So we started looking at, well, does that make sense to actually file a claim? And so one of the questions I had for my agent was, what happens if I file this claim? Like, what are the negative consequences? And the thought being like, this was not something I did. This is not something the tenant did. This is an act of God. So is it going to hurt our rates? And anyway, we were laughing before we hit record because it doesn't affect my rates, but it does remove my no claim discount, which is about 10% of the overall cost of the insurance policy. And so the costs over time actually would start to add up. And that no claims discount goes away for 5 years. So we were really kind of weighing back and forth, like, is it worth it to file this claim or just take on the cost ourselves? Because if you look at the long-term play, one, you're spending more money on the monthly costs. But two, if you have a second claim then, like if there's a, God forbid, a house fire, or a flood or whatever, now all of a sudden you've got other things stacking on top of that. So anyway, long story short, long saga, we are not going to file the claim. We are going to not have insurance help us out. We're just going to eat the cost ourselves to continue to provide that kind of future protection. And again, we hemmed and hawed about which way to go for a while, but once we ran all the numbers, looked at all the different outcomes, and we have the capital to cover the whole cost of the roof anyway, so it just makes sense. But it was an interesting exercise in figuring out how the actual insurance company works and how they would help us out and how they wouldn't and what the right path was.
Well, it sounds like that means you must have a good working relationship with your insurance agent, which I know was one of the key morals of the story of YFP Real Estate Investing episode 14 with Brian Neal. It talked all about having an insurance agent you can trust, that you can go to with these kind of questions. So that sounds really, really helpful. And also it doesn't seem like you like lost the value of insurance. Insurance is still there for something catastrophic.
Exactly.
Just you didn't declare this catastrophic.
Exactly. And that's how we're looking at it. And it times out pretty nicely too. We're actually going through a refinance on this house anyway. So we should be able to pull some cash back out and actually cover the roof with that, with equity. So it will work out. But you're right. Having that good insurance agent, someone that I could call up and say, hey, look, talk me through these options, not just a robot telling me what to do, right? It was someone that I could actually speak to, throw all these things at them, run scenarios, and then figure out the best path forward.
No, that's huge. That kind of expert on the team is just invaluable.
So yeah, so plenty going on. And actually, speaking of which, before we get too far into the weeds and down other rabbit holes, I wanted to make sure we mention this. For those that have not participated before, or for those that may be interested, we are hosting a webinar coming up next week, actually, just about a week after this episode goes live. So it's going to be with YFP on October 12th at 8:30 p.m. We've done similar webinars with APHA in the past, all about how to get started in real estate investing. We're going to do that same topic for the broader YFP community. So definitely keep an eye out for that. If you go over to the YFP Real Estate Investing Facebook group, join that group. We will have the link right there for how to register for that webinar. And that way you guys can join us. We will talk all things how to get started in real estate investing. You'll have full access to David and myself to ask questions. We can go through a whole bunch of scenarios and examples. It'll be a good time. So definitely join us for that. That's again, October 12th at 8:30 p.m., 2021.
And one of the things that we hear either on social media or previous webinars or just questions in general that we've heard frequently is this question of when getting started in real estate investing, is single family home investing better or small multifamily investing better? And this is a tough one because it feels like the short answer we always give is like the classic Tim Baker line, it depends, right? Like there's exactly. There's reasons why one could be good, one could not be good. And it's hard to give like a 90-second kind of soundbite answer on a webinar to this one. So we wanted to unpack this one a little bit more.
Yeah, I think like you said, there's that misconception that multifamily is always better because it means more chances for income, and things like a roof repair are just one roof for four units, right? And so it's got to be better. And I think that's again, a misconception. There are markets and there are areas where single family might be better. And conversely, there are areas where multifamily is better. And so I think what we wanted to do today is really kind of dive through the pros and cons of both so that you can look at your own markets that you're considering and figure out, okay, is multifamily better or does it make more sense to choose single family and why and how do I evaluate that?
Yeah. And I think what we'll do is we'll look through three different markets, three different case studies, you know, a lower price, lower income area, maybe a more expensive area, and then we'll hit something kind of in the middle because we want to talk through several different aspects of what's going on here. And I think one is a market issue, which is where we want to take some examples of some different markets and some numbers to there. And then we'll shift gears and we'll talk about just kind of investor mindset kind of things that depending on how you're wired, your risk tolerance, different things that you think as an investor would make an investment better or worse, then that we can help to go from there. Because I think one of the other things that we see is there's so much debate on this topic in different circles. One of the things we were saying before that we got on for the recording here is that there's not really a wrong answer.
Correct.
Like investors make money doing both. And so as long as you can find the approach that makes most sense for you, that makes you most comfortable, that seems to be the key aspect.
Yeah, I think that's spot on. And like I said, I think, you know, as we work through these case studies, it will become more evident that none of them are bad. It just matters about, you know, which is the right choice for you. And so I guess, David, why don't you start us off? Let's jump in with the lower price neighborhood and get into that case study, because I think that will show people where we're going.
Yeah. So for this first example, we took a property that's a small multifamily, in this case, a duplex, and compared it to a single family that's just a couple blocks away in one area. And we picked these two properties because the duplex is about 1,500 square foot. Single family is about 1,500 square foot. That's a size of a property that translates in a lot of different markets. Mm-hmm. And what we found in this market is that the duplex was a 2-1-1-1. So a 2-bed, 1-bath and a 1-bed, 1-bath unit in this duplex. Both of these properties were $90,000 properties. So I know folks listening in LA and San Francisco are like losing their minds that there's a $90,000 property, let alone a $90,000 duplex. But thinking about these two properties, the 2-1-1-1, the 2-bed, 1-bath unit in this market was renting for about $750. The one bed, one bath unit was renting for about $650. We're kind of taking some liberties with rounding here just to make the numbers a little easier, but just going with us for a minute, $1,400 a month in total rent off of a $90,000 duplex, which one of the rules we've talked about in previous episodes, we've had guests bring up repeatedly, is this 1% rule, where you're looking for 1% of the purchase price or the value of the home as a monthly rent. So in this case, a $90,000 duplex, hopefully you would want it to rent for $900 a month overall. It's just a quick rule of thumb estimate on what would make this property a good property or a bad property investment. Certainly, that's not a perfect rule. I think we'll kind of walk through that here, because I think one of the kickers on this property is by going through the listing, this one was a property where the landlord paid all the utilities, all the snow and lawn, sewer trash, everything. And so we have to think about how those factor into the math here. So in this, we were able to look back at old bills and get information, and it looked like there was about $300 a month that was the electric, gas, water, sewer, trash. Again, we're taking some liberties to make some round numbers to make this all kind of work here. But if you were to assume for a minute $300 a month for that, and at the snow and lawn, let's just put aside $150 a month for snow and lawn. Again, if you're in LA, you're probably not paying for snow removal, but you might have more lawn and other things going on. But when you take the $450 of expenses that wouldn't ordinarily apply to many other rentals and subtract that from the $1,400 a month rent that you collect, now we're down to like $950 a month before we even start getting into repairs and capital expenditures and other things that are going to come up with that property. We've already taken $450 off the top. And so now this $90,000 duplex is looking like we're working from $950 a month. Mm-hmm. The single family that we compared it to in this market was a $90,000 single family, also about 1,500 square foot. But in this case, the tenant paid all the utilities and the tenant also responsible for lawn and snow and everything else. So none of those expenses came in, and the tenant was renting this place for $995 a month. So if we're comparing as much apples to apples as we can here, $950 a month coming in from a $90,000 duplex, $995 coming in a month from a $90,000 single family. So we could talk about the capital expenditures, like your roof example, the things you need to save up for long term. But if it's 1,500 square foot single family, a 1,500 square foot duplex, those are going to be pretty equal. When you talk about the number of toilets and faucets that are going to need replaced over time, those are pretty equal. So from here on out, a lot of the expenses would be pretty consistent, but the rent ends up being higher on the single family.
Yeah, I think that's something that's not evident right off the bat, right? Most people are going to look at that and say, okay, you've got one unit rented for $650 on the duplex, the other rented at $750. Now I'm talking about $1,400 a month. Wow, okay, my cash flow is going to be crazy, right? And I don't have to worry about anything else. But this is exactly why we want you to run all your numbers and put all those important things in. And David, you mentioned getting the old, the old bills, and that's where you got the $300 and the $150. How do you go about doing that typically? Is that something that, you ask the selling agent for, or you have your agent ask, or if it's like a, how do you go about doing that in most cases?
The ways that I've done it, there's probably other ways out there, but the ways that I have done it is to ask the agent and see what they're able to find out from the history there. And I think the other way to do it is to, as you get familiar with other properties in that area. So this is a part of town where we have other properties. And so we're able to better estimate just based on our own experience of a house in this area, we would expect these bills to be about this. We've seen water bills come through for months and months and months for different properties and to see what all that looks like. So those have been two strategies. Anything I'm missing there that you've also done?
Yeah, a real trick of mine, I think, is that you can actually call the local utility and say, hey, for a typical 3-bedroom, 2-bath house in this city or this zip code, what is your average water and sewer bills? And they'll actually give you that information in most cases. Some municipalities may not have that information, or it may be through a different entity, but a lot of times you can actually call the utility company and find that out so that you can verify if the current seller is either telling the truth or, again, if they don't have that information, for example, that's a nice way to kind of parse that out.
Yeah. And another way where that can be nice to get that information or to have some other kind of baseline is, like, let's say that you buy this property and you're expecting the water bill to be $40 a month, and the first water bill comes through and it's $180. we've had that one time where we had a property where the water bill just spiked out of nowhere, and we were able to send in a handyman to look around. We found out that the water heater had a small leak. And so it was just going right down from the water heater right into the drain, and the tenant didn't even notice, but it was a lot of water coming out over not a lot of period of time. So we knew, okay, time to replace the water heater.
One other question I wanted to ask is that, again, in this example, the utilities are making or breaking this deal. So is it typical, would you say, and again, I know this varies by market, so don't take this, you know, too far, but is it typical, would you say, for a duplex to have the landlord paying all those utilities, or are you still trying to split some of those off in certain examples?
So everything that I've seen, and then let me know what you've seen also, but everything that I've seen is that it's very market dependent on what tenants expect. And so like there's one area where we invest where even though you probably could separate the water by different units, nobody does that. And for whatever reason. And so every tenant in town expects that they're not going to pay the water and that the water is therefore included in their rent. So if you were like the one person that had this is this, and you also pay the water bill, like the tenants probably like that's just going to feel weird and not typical for the area. So some of those things I think are area dependent, but I know as a landlord, one of the things that I'm looking for, at least, and different people may be different, but one of the things I'm looking for at least is simplicity. And so not having to get all these bills and split them up or build them into the rent and all those kind of things. There's certainly something simple about passing those on directly to the tenant.
Yeah, and something interesting about my market, at least here in Cleveland, is that the city of Cleveland does all the water for, gosh, most of Cuyahoga County. And the way it works is that they actually will not allow the, like Cleveland Water will not allow tenants to have the bill in their name. You have to have the owner of that property on the water bill. So even if you split out everything else, you still have to have that water bill in your name and you're paying it. Now, and again, in a lot of cases, especially with single families or with split meters or something like that, you can pass those along to the tenants. In fact, the unit that I'm working on right now that we're getting rented out, we pay the water bill every single month. I take basically a PDF of that water bill. I send it off to the tenant at the end of the month and say, here, you have 2 weeks to pay this bill. I've already paid it so that the city's not going to come after me, but it's part of their required bills every single month for the tenant to cover. And then it counts like rent. So if they miss that payment, it has a late fee and everything goes along with it. So it's, even though we're the ones on the actual bill, it's still being paid by the tenant and passed along to them, which again is typical for our market.
Okay, so looking at these two properties as a comparison, a $90,000 duplex, $90,000 single family, even though the rents look very different on the sticker price, as we break it down and we think through some of the different expenses that come in there, we end up really close, about $45 different, even with the single family potentially coming ahead. But that's very close. We'll talk kind of as we get later on about some of just the inherent issues between a single family and a duplex and things like that. So you could consider this one almost a wash, or maybe that single family coming out just a little bit ahead there when we break the math down a little more, at least in this specific market with those kind of considerations. So Nate, can you tell us a little bit about the more expensive market, at least more expensive for the Midwest?
Yeah. We'll call this like a mid-tier market, right? Especially for Midwest. Again, not comparing ourselves to New York, California, places like that. But the mid-tier market out here, right? We're talking about homes in the $100,000 to $250,000 range, somewhere in that neighborhood. And so what we find is that, and again, I think this is something unique here, but it's translatable all over the country, is that if you look at a particular market that has that mid-tier pricing, usually you're going to start to find the really good school districts, and that's why people are moving into an area, or really good amenities, and that's why people are targeting a particular area. And so with that comes occasionally the need for more space. And some people want a single family home over a duplex, over that shared space. And so again, that doesn't matter in all markets, especially if you're talking about a place where multifamily living is the norm. But out here in the suburbs, again, when we're looking at this kind of mid-tier level, single family homes feel like the norm. And so people kind of want that. And so one of the things that we ran into in one of the markets that I invest in locally is that if you compare the single family rent rates to the multifamily rent rates, there is a drastic difference. And so we have a property right now that actually it's listed for sale. Hopefully by the time this podcast goes live, I'll have my tenant locked in and good to go. But it's listed as a 4-bedroom, 1.5 bath. It is around 1,600 square feet. And we have it up right now for $1,850 a month is our rent rate. If you look at other duplexes or multifamilies in the area, they could be, you know, 8-bedroom, 4-bath, which means that each half of that duplex is the same bedroom, bathroom count, similar square footage. You're pulling in about $1,400-$1,500 a month in rent. So about $300 less. Now, again, that may not matter when you're talking about if you're buying that duplex for the right price. But what we're seeing is that those duplexes can be double the price of that single family home. So I'm buying that single family home for $130, but the duplex is costing me $260. But I'm not doubling my rental income. I'm just doubling the cost. So if you're looking at it from the perspective of, well, more is always better, look at what those actual properties are bringing in and compare the single family rate versus the multifamily rate. One of the interesting things that I'm running into right now, though, is that there are fewer single family homes on the market right now because they're so desirable. And so when I look at like my rental listing on Zillow, Zillow's Zestimate for the rent, which I hate, by the way, if I haven't mentioned, but Zillow's Zestimate for the rent is actually really low because it's comparing us to other multifamily homes. The algorithm isn't smart enough to pick out multifamily versus single family. If you do it yourself and actually break out single family rent rates, our rent is right in the middle of the road. But if you compare it across the board to multi and single family, it looks like we're priced way too high. And so I guarantee I'm going to get somebody that sends me an email at some point and says like, this is way above this estimate. Why are you charging this much? Like, but again, if you actually do the math and look at the numbers and look at the history of what's been going on in the neighborhood, you can see that the single family rent rates are just that much higher. And you can use that either to your advantage if you're an investor, or again, just trying to find a way to compare those side by side.
Now, that's such a big catch about that specific neighborhood. And I think part of the value of knowing how neighborhoods work down at that very micro level. So for those that are trying to figure out and just got like immediately intimidated by that, like, oh my gosh, what if I don't know that? Like, how do you figure that out in a very specific neighborhood?
So it's funny you say that because I actually had this like terrible panic when we first bought the property back in 2019, this particular one I'm talking about. I did the analysis and I ran it based on single family homes. Like my realtor training kicked in and I looked at comparables, right? I pulled up MLS comparables and I said, like, let's do this. I looked at all those. I looked at rent rates. I felt really good that like, you know, 1800 or so is about the rent rate for this place. Well, then as we were under contract and about to waive contingencies, I did the analysis again, like always double check your math, right? I did it 6 different times, but I did it like a different way. And I pulled in the multifamily examples and all of a sudden the projected rent, the average comp went way down. And my wife looked at me like, what are you doing? Like, what are we doing? Why are we buying this place? Like, you know, the numbers aren't going to work anymore. And so I took a really hard step back and I said, like, what am I missing? And then I realized that, oh yeah, if you throw multifamilies into this, it really brings down the rent rate. And you can't just look at, is it a 4-bedroom unit? You have to look at the amenities of that property. What are you actually getting? So it just takes time. It takes someone knowing the market very well or quickly learning the market, as it was in my case. But it just takes that time and that effort to actually dive in and say, okay, if this place is renting for X, why is it renting for that much more than this place over here? Or why is it renting for that much less than this place over there? And trying to follow those properties so that you can figure out where those differences are coming from.
Yeah. And I think that the other way that I've got some of that information in a double check fashion, because right, we're all pharmacists, we're all risk averse, we're all very into double checking things, right? Like that's what we do for a living. And so I found local property managers that specialize in that area can be very fluent in things that will make something rent higher or lower. Like I remember walking through one of the first properties that we were looking at and we thought, oh, we have to rip out this kitchen and put in a new kitchen to maximize rent because that's what they all do in HGTV. So like we have to, right? And so The property manager looked at me and was like, no, this kitchen's fine. Mm-hmm. Look at every other house in this neighborhood. They all have laminate countertops. You don't have to come in here and put in granite. You don't have to come in and do this. Like, yeah, you probably need new appliances, but stop there. It's not going to rent for $1 more if you come in and maximize this kitchen somehow. So yeah. I think those kind of, you know, phone a friend type things as we continue talking about the value of a team, just absolutely huge.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that. I think, again, finding that local expert and whether it's you, because you're spending the time to make yourself that local expert or tapping into someone who already is, it's a great way to have success. All right. So David, I want to jump then to the kind of the higher price point. Again, we're not talking huge dollars here just to keep things comparable, but what's that higher price point look like when you're comparing duplex to single family?
Yeah, this is another, again, high price doesn't really fit when you look at other markets, but at least in my area, this would be a more expensive mm-hmm. place. And so this would be, we're looking at maybe a $250,000 duplex in town. And this is where the rents are much higher for me, which is like $1,000 and $1,200 for the two bed and the three bed unit in this larger place. So if we put that all together, we're talking, you know, $2,200. And in this area, this is with tenant paid utilities. So the lawn, snow, water, sewer is about the only thing that the landlord pays on this. And so if we subtract that out, let's just say for round numbers, it's $2,000 a month in rents after those kind of landlord paid things that are unique to a multifamily property. And what was interesting about this one is I was looking at the duplex and I was looking at a single family house across the street from each other and trying to figure out the difference here, because the two properties were about the same square footage, about the same look, about the same roof, about the same everything. So a lot of their just general expenses are going to be pretty consistent. Like when this house ends up needing windows and siding someday, like they're both the same amount of siding, same amount of windows, all those kind of things. But the single family was worth about $200,000. So a decent savings for just a large single family compared to a duplex where presumably at some point in time, that large single family was chopped up into two units. And so looking at this one, $250,000 renting for $2,000 a month, or $200,000 big house was going to rent for $1,500 a month. There just seemed to be a ceiling on rental value in the area that no one really was going to pay that much extra for a four bed or five bed house in this area. So there's a big jump in going for that same size of property by the fact that it was split into two units with an extra essentially $500 a month of net rent there for just that $50,000 additional increase in cost.
I think this is where that misconception originally comes from, right? I think most people, when they're looking at markets, this is the kind of market they're looking at, where you're getting these duplexes that collectively your net income is thousands higher than what you could get for this for a single family home, just because, like you said, there's only so much you can pay, right? Like nobody's renting a single family home for $4,000 a month in these markets, right? You're just not doing it. But you can get a triplex that's all renting at $1,300 a month on each unit, and all of a sudden you are pulling in $4,000. This is where that multifamily obviously makes the most sense, especially if the price points are there, just because the single families, you can only push them so high. So I think this is why it's so important to evaluate your particular market and looking at what the actual rent rates are and how much you can push it on both sides so that you can understand which way to go.
Yeah. And then I think there's some other differences that can factor in here. Like I know one that you've taught me about recently is the pet rent mm-hmm. and how that all works, because I think that pets make a big difference in a single family versus a multifamily. If two sure. people are sharing the same, two tenants are sharing a backyard and they both have dogs that don't like each other, like that sounds like a bad recipe right there. But talk for a little bit about pet rents if you could.
Yeah. And this is an interesting concept. So like on multifamilies, like I won't do pets on multifamilies just because I know it's just a bigger problem. Like you said, it lends itself to more liability. It lends itself to more tenant complaints. But on single families, I love to include pets because I have a dog. I love having a dog. I know there's tons of people out there that want to be able to bring their furry friends with them. And so like, I think that's super important. And in Ohio, there's, and again, different states have different laws, but in Ohio, for example, you can't charge what's called a non-refundable deposit. I see this listed actually all the time illegally, where someone will say it's a $1,500 a month with a $1,500 deposit and a $500 non-refundable pet deposit. Again, different states have different laws. Please consult your own local laws, but like you actually can't do that here. So what we do and what is allowed in Ohio is a pet rent, where you're saying, okay, if you're going to have a pet, it's going to be an extra $35 or $40 or $50 a month in rent to have that pet along with you, just like, you know, having an extra tenant in the house, basically. And that's a way to basically say, look, as long as they're there, the rent goes up by this amount, and it's basically covering the cost of that pet. And so it's a nuanced difference, but make sure that if you are the one listing this property and you're not going through a property manager, you understand that difference, because you could be doing something against fair housing rules or against property laws if you are not following that very, very closely.
Yeah, we could probably do a whole episode on pets and right. like how some people strategically say we are totally fine with pets as a way to capitalize in a niche audience of tenants that really want to have a pet friendly place with a fenced in yard and like all the things that a pet owner would consider. And then there's other people that have said like, there was a cat that peed in this rental one time and it took thousands of dollars to fix it. I'm never renting to someone with pets again. Yeah. So like there's definite two sides to that coin. And so more things to think through or to have that conversation with the property manager and get advice as you're jumping in.
We should do a whole pet episode. If you've got a good story about a pet in your rental, send that to us in the YFP Facebook group or shoot us an email. I'd love to see that. I think we should do a whole episode on pets. I think that'd be good. All right. Well, David, I want to jump for a second because I think we've got, you know, those great examples that we walked through, the kind of the lower price point where the utilities really made a difference. We talked through the mid-tier market where the single family homes versus duplexes, the single family homes were actually bringing in much higher rent. And then there's other areas where, you know, that ability to stack units starts to stack the dollars. And so it can really start to jump up on the rental income potential. But I think there's other things to consider besides just these three kind of examples, these case studies that we went to. And so we put these together. We'll go back and forth. We'll kind of rapid fire through these other considerations because just the dollars is not the only thing to take into account. So let's rapid fire through these and see what other considerations people should think about.
Yeah. So the first one we wanted to talk about was margin dollars versus margin percent. This is something that an independent pharmacist owner taught me about thinking about the margin that you make on a $10 generic drug. Even if your acquisition cost is like pennies and you're able to sell it for $10, there's kind of a cap to your margin there. Whereas let's say you have a $400 brand only drug, even if your acquisition cost is pretty close to that, there might be a greater margin there that someone might make. And I know those examples can go back and forth and all those things. So like, don't think too much about those specifics. But the point is that there are some medications that are dispensed where there's a greater return on your time because it oftentimes takes the same amount of time to dispense either medication. And I think that's a very similar concept to real estate investing. It might take you the same amount of time on two different properties. And so what is that time return and what is all the hassle and all that kind of factor into if you're looking to keep your investing simple and kind of as a side hustle to your main work as a pharmacist?
Like you said, if it means 10 single family homes versus three triplexes, right? Is it worth it to do, is it, you know, how much more work is it to have those 10 single families versus three triplexes, for example? You know, and where is that time going? I think that's a great example. And then number two that we mentioned was the limited number of conventional mortgages. So a lot of people talk about, you know, I want to get to the point where I'm making X in cash flow, or I have enough units to provide X in monthly passive income. And one of the limiting steps to that, if you're doing them in your personal name, for example, is that you can only have 10 properties in most cases. You can only have 10 mortgages in your personal name before you have to, you know, go to commercial lending. And so if that number you need to reach your passive income number is 20 units or 25 units, you could easily price yourself out or max yourself out if you were just doing the single family side. So multifamily is an interesting way to get around, or not get around, but to work with that 10 mortgage limit, because you could have a 4-unit place, but it's only one mortgage. And if the numbers work, you can start to scale your business that much faster without reaching that limit on the personal mortgages that you can take on. So just kind of an interesting consideration for the long term, but something to think about.
Yeah. And with that too, there's often that debt to income ratio factor that people talk a lot about. And so making sure, particularly that those first few investments, if you're really tight on that debt to income factor, which talking with a lender can help to unpack some of those numbers. But as you work through that, making sure that your cash flow per mortgage, particularly in those first few, is higher so that it doesn't throttle you out of subsequent mortgages. If you're cash flow negative on those first few, that can really hurt your DTI. Definitely. And make it harder to get subsequent mortgages there. So the third piece, we talked about the time per deal, that kind of margin dollars versus margin percent. We talked about the limited number of mortgages. The third piece is that small multifamily, we talk so much about safety around here. Pharmacists are very safety oriented. So one safety piece of small multifamilies is if your tenant moves out in the middle of the night and calls you later and say, here's my keys, which we had that this week happen to us. So if that happens, then if your tenant moves out in the middle of the night, if you have a small multifamily and you have two tenants in there, you're still collecting rent from the other one if the one moves out, or if you have kind of natural vacancy, which happens. People don't live for 100 years in these properties, right? They're always moving in and moving out. If you have that, where you have that natural vacancy, you still have, you know, roughly, if you have a duplex, half of your income coming in. If you have a fourplex, roughly three quarters of the income still coming in. So vacancy doesn't tend to be as detrimental in a small multifamily as it might be in a single family house.
Definitely a great point. And then I'll put my realtor hat on for a second and just tell you that in general, it is easier to sell a single family home. Now, again, I know this is market specific, but in general, there are more potential buyers for a single family home than there are for a multifamily. Generally speaking, the multifamily properties are going to investors or someone that's okay with a house hack, but it's a smaller pool of people, right? Anybody can buy a single family home, whether you're going to be the person that lives there, you're an investor, it's across the board. And so if you're looking at exit strategies, which again, David and I talk about all the time, having multiple exit strategies for any investment deal, whether we're going to flip it, rent it, whatever, exit strategies are super important. And if you're looking at single family, there are just more exit strategies. It's easier to flip. It's easier to sell. Again, in most cases, I'm speaking generally, but that is something to keep in mind. And appreciation works differently from single family to multifamily as well. Generally speaking, single families appreciate a bit better because, again, more buyers available that are pushing up those prices. So if you're looking at the exit strategy standpoint, again, echoing off the safety thing that David spoke about, that is another factor to consider.
Yeah, I think one thing that happens on episodes like this where you do these kind of deeper dives and we talk really into the weeds about different concepts is I know that one inadvertent consequence can be that people get really just scared of like, oh my gosh, I don't know any of this. I shouldn't be doing this at all. I can never buy a house. This is a terrible, terrible idea. I'm never going to be a real estate investor. And like, we definitely don't want that. So I think one theme that I want to just, I know we've mentioned a couple times here. I want to pull it out one more time as we wrap the episode here. Is the episode of investing in a team format where you've got a realtor that can advise you on this. You've got a property manager that can advise you, you know, and they can help with other nuanced details that we may not have even talked about. Like what's the difference in a vacancy rate between a small multifamily and a single family? Do you have less turnover in a specific submarket in single families, or do people that move into small multifamilies tend to live there for a while? Like, is that a area of reduced vacancy? And so many of these things can be market specific. And so having that agent, having that property manager that operates in that market can just be incredibly helpful for making sure that you're finding a deal that lines up with specifically what you say is a win.
Yeah. And to drop another shameless plug, I mean, if you are looking for an agent in a particular market, we have investor-friendly agents in our network we would love to get you guys connected with. If you head on over to yfprealestate.com, you can look up, you know, I need an agent, and we can actually have a phone call. You and I can chat all about what your needs are. And we've connected tons of pharmacists with local investor-friendly agents to help with exactly this kind of stuff, right? Finding a property manager, finding contractors, figuring out how to navigate the market so that, again, this stuff doesn't become overwhelming. It becomes informational and helpful. And so we're here to help with that. And we'd love to see if there's somebody that we can get you connected with. So head on over to yfprealestate.com and you can look that up and learn more about it there. So as we wrap up, David, I think this concept is deep, but I think we've hit on some high points, which are really important. We're going to go more in detail on general how to get started in real estate investing at our webinar next week. So again, if you are interested in joining that, that is on October 12th at 8:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Again, head over to the YFP Real Estate Investing Facebook group. Make sure that you are a member there. Join that group, and then you'll have access to that webinar. You can get registered and learn more about how to get started. So we can talk more about the basics rather than just diving into the deep stuff here.
And so while you're in the YFP Real Estate Investing Facebook group, make sure that you take a minute, introduce yourself, and ask any questions along these lines as well, because I think that's a great spot just to get more opinions on these issues, because this is very opinion oriented. We can both talk about different things to consider, different opinions, different examples in different markets, but there's still not a real straightforward answer. There's a lot of people that have been really successful at investing in single families, other people that have been really successful investing in small multifamilies. So it can all be done. It's more about figuring out what you feel is best for you as an investor. And some of the discussion in the Facebook group can be a great way to get those thoughts moving.
Yeah, awesome. Well, David, again, great chat, and we'll talk to everybody next week.
Thanks so much for joining us for the YFP Real Estate Investing Podcast. If you liked what you heard on today's episode, please leave us a review and subscribe to the show so you never miss an episode. If you have a question, know someone who'd make a good guest for the show, or want to connect with Nate and David, head over to yfprealestate.com or join the growing YFP Real Estate Investing Facebook group. See you next time.